Games to Keep the Dark Away, a Sharon McCone mystery by Marcia Muller, narrated by Laura Hicks. Chapter 1. The wind whipped my jacket open as I went up to the guardrail. The sheer, rock-strewn face of Potrero Hill dropped away for 50 yards or more, and I could look down on the roofs of the houses below. I turned, pulling the jacket tightly around me, and walked down the street from where I'd parked at the dead end. Broken glass and other debris crunched beneath my feet. All the buildings, save two, in this short block, were condemned or half-demolished. They stood silent in the early October dusk, gaping holes where windows had once been, jagged timbers silhouetted against the dying light. I shivered, only partly from the biting wind. Number 21 was surrounded by a 6-foot redwood fence on which the number was spelled out in carved letters. I pushed through the gate into a deep front yard that was choked with vegetation. A gravel walk overhung by scraggly palm trees led to the front door. I went up and rang the bell. In a moment, the door opened a crack, and a pale, nondescript face peered at me over the security chain. Yes? Mr. Snelling? I'm Sharon McCone, the investigator from All Souls Legal Cooperative. I passed one of my cards through the narrow opening. After a few seconds, the chain rattled, the door opened, and I was admitted into a dark hallway. The man quickly rechained the door, then turned to me, his hand outstretched. It's good of you to come so promptly. I'm Abe Snelling. I clasped his slender, long-fingered hand. Its palm was moist. I'm glad to meet you. I admire your photographs. Thank you. Come this way. He led me down the hall toward the back of the house. So far, I couldn't tell much about Snelling, except that he was short, shorter than my own 5'6", and that his blonde hair was thinning at the crown. I followed him into a large, white-carpeted living room and stopped, caught up in the view. In the foreground, the lights of Potrero Hill cascaded down into the industrial flatlands below. The warehouses, oil storage tanks, and ships in dry dock were softened by the dusk, and beyond them the water of the bay lay flat and quiet. My gaze moved to the East Bay Hills and the shining chain of bridge that linked the two shores. "Your view of the bay and the hills is spectacular," I said. "Yes, I enjoy it during the day." Snelling crossed the dark room and drew the draperies with a decisive snap of a cord. He then went around flicking on table lamps. The walls of the room were also white and covered with his photographs. The furnishings were severely modern. I must have had an odd expression on my face because Snelling stopped and gave me a lopsided grin, his head cocked to one side. "I can't stand to have the drapes open after dark."
"It is pretty bleak looking out there."
"No, it's not that." He motioned at a chair. "Actually, it's snipers."
"What?"
"I have a ridiculous fear of snipers."
"Oh."
I sat down in one of those chrome and leather chairs that are surprisingly comfortable in spite of their looks. Snelling sat across the glass coffee table from me and fumbled in his shirt pocket for a pack of cigarettes.
"It's stupid. But when I was in my teens, one of the neighborhood kids shot his mother. She was standing at the kitchen window, and he went out in the backyard and shot her through the glass with his hunting rifle. A thing like that makes an impression on you." "I guess so."
"Anyway, since then, I've never been able to have the curtains open after dark. I know it's stupid, but I can't seem to help it."
"We all have those kinds of fears," I said, thinking of my own phobia about birds.
Snelling fiddled with a chrome table lighter, and I watched him, disappointed that he didn't fit my...
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.